All right, good evening. I want to welcome you. Cameron, why don't you throw that first slide up? I'm Claude Barraby. I'm the director of the Naval Academy Museum, and I want to thank you all for coming here. I want to say a special thanks to the leadership, history, and CNAV departments who helped to make this happen tonight. Do we have any firsties here? They're all at the Acme, aren't they? I know where they are. That's okay. I'll get them later. I want to also thank some wonderful supporters of the museum. We have a number of classes from what we call the syndicate, class of 50, class of 51, class of 56, 58, 98. Did I miss anybody? Sorry about that. 66 is here. Thanks, sir. So welcome. All right, this is how we're going to run it tonight. After I hand it off to Captain Harris, both the COs are going to give briefs to you of about 15 minutes or so. Captain Harris is going to kick things off with a few questions, and then we're going to open it up for questions. So I would ask that when I make that announcement, you line up behind one of these two mics and just have a nice, succinct question ready. We're going to try to get in as many questions and answers prior to that, okay? This is truly a unique event, and you're part of a great learning experience. They are all here for you, especially the midshipmen, to learn about what it's like out there under adverse conditions. These are two of the books. Those two books about the events, some of your classes should have submitted maybe two or three chapters from each of those books as read-aheads, I think from CNAV. So I would strongly encourage you to read those books. They're incredible. There was another ship, the USS Stark, during the Iran-Iraq War, that was hit by two Iraqi Exocet missiles. And just to let you know some of the things that we have at the museum, we just got this a little while ago. One of those Exocet missiles did not detonate. And that's what we've got right over here. So if after the event you want to take a look at what an Exocet missile looks like, close up and personal, feel free before we get it ready for display with the model of the USS Stark. All right, to kick things off, Captain Robbie Harris, our moderator, had a long, distinguished career in the Navy. He is the CO of the USS Conley and Desron 32. He's currently the Director of Advanced Concepts for Maritime Systems at Lockheed Martin, and he is the chairman of the Baltimore Council on Foreign Affairs. We certainly welcome him, and Robbie, the show is yours. Thank you. Right.
Claude, I thank you very much. If I may ask for the first slide, please. Very good. Okay, and since I cannot read it back there from here, I'll stand up here so that I can indeed read. Before I do the introduction, bring the slide back up. Let's get the ground rules straight here. This is not going to be a fun evening if you guys and gals just sit there. For this to be a fun evening, this is going to be interactive, which means you ask questions. The captains over here have been instructed. They have firm guidance, 15 minutes and only 15 minutes. And after that, we're going to do Q's and A's. They do the A's, you do the Q's, and most of the Q's are going to come from out there. So pay attention. Let's make it interactive. That way it'll be fun. This is not a one-way street, just these two captains talking. Okay, here's the proposition. This is Robbie's proposition. The three most fundamental responsibilities of a surface commanding officer are, number one, the safe navigation and operation of the ship, i.e., don't hazard your vessel, okay? The second fundamental, at least in my view, the second fundamental, ensure that the ship can fight to its full potential. And you see in parentheses there, think Taffy 3, USS Johnston, USS Samuel B. Roberts in the Second World War. And you, Claude recommended two books for you to read. Here's a third one. The Last Stand of the Tin Can Sailors. The Last Stand of the Tin Can Sailors. Fantastic book. And why do I mention it? I mention it because of the second fundamental here. The second fundamental here. Ensure that your ship can fight to its full potential, even after being struck. And the amazing thing about these destroyers and destroyer escorts in World War II is these ships would take pounding after pounding
lose an engine room, lose a fire room, lose after steering, lose a 5-inch mount, lose a 3-inch mount, and continue fighting. Continue fighting until the ship sank, if that's what happened. That's why the second fundamental is there. Ensure the ship can fight to its full potential. And then the third fundamental, from my perspective, ensure robust ability to control damage, i.e. insist on expertise in damage control to keep the ship in a state of maximum warfighting readiness against all odds. And that's what we're going to talk about tonight. These two COs here, the commanding officer of Samuel B. Roberts, Paul Rinn, and the CO of Cole, Commander Lippold, they fulfill the third fundamental here to the nth degree. In fact, one of the things you're going to hear tonight from Captain Rinn is that the folks up at MIT and at David Taylor Model Basin have said to him that his ship should have sunk after 1 hour. Should have sunk after 1 hour. But why is it that it didn't sink? It's because of the leadership that Paul Rinn had provided aboard that ship to ensure that it didn't sink after 1 hour, which is what the naval architect said should have happened. USS Cole, an unprecedented attack. You've all seen the pictures. The engineering space is fully, fully exposed. Tons and tons and tons and tons of water going aboard that ship, and it didn't sink. Why did it not sink? Because of the leadership that he provided, that Commander Lippold provided in that ship. So three fundamentals in my view. Number one, don't hazard your ship. That's most fundamental. Number two, ensure a full warfighting capability against all odds and ensure that your ship can control damage, i.e., although the naval architects say it should sink, ensure that it doesn't sink. So it's the third fundamental that we're going to talk about the most tonight. Now, having said that, it's my pleasure to introduce these two very distinguished commanding officers. First, Captain Paul Rinn. Paul, I know Paul personally. We were fellow department heads down in Charleston, South Carolina in the 1970s. Competing ships, if you will, but we were buddies throughout that, and we've been buddies ever since. A destroyer man through and through, first division officer tour aboard Scarsdale. He went to Vietnam for shore duty after that, 220 days in combat over there in the Mekong Delta. He comes back, he's a department head aboard the Stark, which is a 1052 in Charleston. Commander command tour is of the Samuel B. Roberts, which we'll hear a whole lot about tonight. And then lastly, he was the CO of the Leyte Gulf. And while Paul was in command, the Leyte Gulf was distinguished as the most capable, the best cruiser in the Atlantic Fleet during his tour. He's a recipient of any number of awards, which you've probably read about in his bio that was online. Commander Kirk Lippold, also a cruiser destroyer man through and through, although his first division officer tour was aboard a Gator, an LST, as I recall. From the Gator, he goes to another destroyer. His first department head tour is aboard the USS Arleigh Burke, DDG 51, the famous DDG 51. John Morgan was your CO, I take it, right? A fantastic ship. From there, he goes to a cruiser to be the XO, and his cruiser was the name is here somewhere, and I don't see it on my notes. But anyway, he was the XO of a cruiser. And from his cruiser XO tour, he was the CO of Cole, and you all know what happened after that. So with that, I'm going to turn it over first to Captain Paul Rinn to talk about his experience aboard Sammy B. Roberts. Then we'll follow with Commander Lippold's comments about his command of Cole and the events there following. A couple of questions, which I'll pose, and then I'm going to turn it over to you. And remember, for this to be fun, it's going to be interactive, so I encourage you to ask questions. Paul, over to you, sir.
First slide, please. Well, good evening. How are you? My wife always reminds me when I come to these things that there's an awful lot of people in the audience who weren't born when this all took place. So I'll give you a quick tutorial on FFG-7s. You know, when they were built, a lot of people said a lot of negative things about them, you know, square peg and a round hole, and they weren't capable. And I have to tell you that when they said that, it was mostly from people who hadn't been to sea on them and didn't understand capability and didn't understand what Robbie was talking about, and that's fighting your ship to the fullest. So I want to tell you a little bit about Samuel B. Roberts, and I'll let you decide for yourself. A launcher up forward, we carried 20-plus standard missiles. We'd engage somebody in line of sight 16 miles. We could shoot at somebody over the horizon. Six harpoons as well. We trained the ship to be able to shoot salvos of standard missiles and harpoons in 30-second intervals. Think about that in defending against that. A 76-millimeter gun with 850 rounds. An engineering plant with two gas turbine engines that you could get up to 30 knots and almost the length of the ship and stop on a dime. An incredibly highly maneuverable variable pitch propellers. And we dragged an SQR-19 array that we had chased two U.S. Los Angeles-class submarines and held them for seven days down in the Guantanamo Bay op area. So the ship was very capable, 220 men. And what was the thing that we really stuck to? As Robbie said, be able to fight your ship to the fullest. Take your capabilities and train your people to take them to the limit of what they can do. And that's what we did on Samuel B. Roberts. But the other thing that was important about this ship was the name. Samuel B. Roberts was the third ship named after the coxswain who won the Navy Cross at Guadalcanal. And heritage and tradition was incredibly powerful on that ship. We made sure that every crew member knew that they knew what the history of that name was and what the history of the ship was, that they walked in the footsteps of their predecessors. And they took that on board, and they understood. And then on a funny note, I always said to them, we're here to be number one. We want to be the best. We want to be the Yankees, not the Chicago Cubs. Oh, I'm sorry if you're from Chicago. Seriously, though, the reason is there's no bands on the battlefield, and there's no do-overs. Second place means you die. So you have to be ready every day to fight, and you have to be prepared to meet your adversary. And so that was the thing that we indoctrinated in the crew. And we emphasized drilling and practice and everything that was important. But the most important thing for all of you to remember is on Samuel B. Roberts, we remembered and stressed that your people are the most important things. You are never going to be successful unless your people perform to the limits of their ability. And your job as a leader is to bring them to places where they never thought they could get, to teach them that they could be the best. Next slide, please. So how do we do that? Well, heck, we had a pyramid, and every sailor who reported aboard the ship came to my cabin. I sat them down. I mean, it was kind of interesting. They were from 46 states in the Union, a little socioeconomic experiment. And we talked about the goals. What's the goal? You know, there's a lot of ships in the Navy, a lot of businesses out there that when you ask the employees, what's your goal? The employees go, I have no idea. And what's your role in the goal? That was the second thing. What's important? And how are you going to achieve that? And how are you going to learn? How are you going to qualify? The third thing is, what's the strategy and how are we going to do that and make sure the entire chain of command knows that and they buy into it and they're all on board? The third one is, you can't just order people to do things. You have to motivate them. You have to communicate with them, and communication means not just barking orders and giving direction, but listening, and listening to what they have to say and applying it to be the most effective that you can possibly be. And the last thing that we emphasized and was very important on Samuel B. Roberts was interaction and synergy. It's going to come out when I talk a little bit about the mining. One of the things that is always important on ships is everybody says, hey, my division is the best, but those guys over there, they're all screwed up. Well, then maybe you need to learn about them. And the most important thing was to get everybody to work as a team. And so to do that was to make them interoperative. And two things that I wanted to stress, the Navy requires you, at least they used to require you, to rig casualty power once a year and demonstrate it. On Samuel B. Roberts, we rigged it every month and we powered it up. And my XO came to me one night and said, you know, Captain, the guys think you're kind of over the top on this. And I turned around and I looked at John Eckelberry and said, you want to do this for the first time when you're in water up to your ankles? and were on fire and sinking somewheres in an engagement? And he said, no, sir. And I said, then we're going to do it every month. But we're not going to just do it with engineers. We're going to do it with postal clerks. We're going to do it with the cooks. We're going to do it with OSs. We're going to do it with yeomen. Everybody is going to know how to do all of this stuff. And that synergy and that interoperability created tremendous dividends for us when the rubber met the road. Next slide, please. So you take a ship, and you win the battle in 10 months, and you're nominated for the Battenberg Cup, and you have outstanding oppies and everything else, and you think, oh, I can sit back and relax, and then you get the message that says, pack up and go to the Persian Gulf 10 months early. So we did. And when we arrived in the Persian Gulf, our job was to do convoys. There were three ships over there with us. The Simpson was with us, and the Sims, I think it was, or the Wainwright, I'm sorry. And our job was to do convoying of U.S. flag tankers and gas tankers through the Straits of Hormuz. Why was that? Because the Iranians and the Iraqis were attacking roughly 10 to 14 ships every week in the Gulf, either the Revolutionary Guard or the standard Iranian guys. So we went in and established cordon sanitaires around our ships, and we took them through the Straits, and we took them all the way up to Kuwait and other places in Saudi Arabia. And we told the Iranians and the Iraqis, if you come inside the cordon sanitaire, we will engage you. There'll be no questions asked. We will come for you. And they tried us a couple of times, and we went after them with missiles on the rail and advised them that they had 60 seconds to clear or we would shoot them. And they left, and they went away. So that was a very successful evolution. And at the end of that time frame, we did 14 convoys. There were no attacks on our ships. Admiral Less flew aboard the ship, and he told me, there's still 6 attacks a week being conducted in the Straits of Hormuz. I want you to go to the Straits of Hormuz, and I want you to shut the Iranians down. I want them to stop engaging ships and shooting them. Don't start the next war, but if it starts, Commander, you finish it. So with that, I asked him if I could have that in writing. He said no. Okay. With that, we went to the Straits of Hormuz, and in a period of time, next slide, please. We engaged the Sabalon and the Sahan continuously every day for about a week, and the attacks dropped from 6 to 2, and then the last 2 weeks we were there, they stopped completely and they went into port. We felt very good about ourselves. We felt very confident. We felt we had shut them down and we had run them off. They could outrun us, but they couldn't get away from us with that missile that we had on the rail. And this was a picture taken from a tanker that was passing by one of the days that we ran Sabalon off. So at the end of that period of time, we were directed to do one more convoy. Our 14th one, I was the convoy commander, and we took it up to Kuwait. And when we were done, we were very low on fuel. We had about 29% on board, and we were sent to rendezvous with the Seattle in the eastern part of the Persian Gulf. And we dropped everybody off and headed on our way. Next slide, please. And we were rounding Qatar, just west of the Rashdam oil fields, at about 29 knots. I was in my cabin complaining to the chief cook that we had too much spinach on the menu. And he told me that we needed more iron. So all of a sudden, the ship started to shudder. We were at condition 3, modified Zebra, hatches down, scuttles open, actually in a full combat condition. When the ship started to shudder, I went to the bridge, and next slide, please. And what I saw was this. We had moved into what appeared to be 2 mines about 500 yards off our bow, and one mine about 350 yards off our starboard side. Stopped the ship. I got on the 1MC and notified the crew that I thought we were in a minefield, ordered the helicopter to start turning up and getting ready to go out and see if there were more mines in the field, and was eminently confident that I could back the ship with my APUs back down my wake, which I could see about 8 miles behind me, and get away. Called Mideast Force and reported that we had the mines 800 yards away or 600 yards away. They told us not to get any closer than 1,500 yards. That was not too helpful. And we started to back. Actually, they were very, very helpful throughout these things. That's not a fair comment. I ordered the crew to come up above the main deck because I realized that if a mine strike hit down there, they would really be hurt and damaged. And one of my sailors, a rather unique individual, stayed forward. His name was Fireman Tilly in AMR-1. and decided that the Navy might need number one diesel, which is in the forward part of the ship, which is a very serious thing because in the end that's a very critical decision that he made. The rest of the sailors came up above the main deck as fast as they could, and as they were coming up and reporting in that they were clear of the area, and I started backing the ship down the wake and was backing it for about 35 or 40 minutes and had moved a short distance, actually. Next slide, please. When this is one of the mines that was in the minefield. There were 15 mines in the minefield, and the one that got us is not obviously not this one. Next slide, please. After about 40 minutes backing down the minefield, the largest explosion that I have experienced in my time in the Navy took place. It blew the ship about 10 or 15 feet vertical in the air. It snapped us completely in two. It blew a 30-foot hole in the side of the ship. It broke our keel and put 2,000 tons of water inside the ship in the space of about 60 seconds. The flames were about 100 feet above the ship and destroyed our gas turbine engines and our entire engine room. We had two spaces completely destroyed immediately, AMR-3 in the main engine room. And at this point, my immediate concerns in my mind is, and what I haven't told you, as we were heading to this rendezvous, the Subalon had appeared in the north about 30 miles away and was shadowing us, and an Iranian P-3 had flown over us twice. It was kind of a usual event, but we didn't really seem to understand what was going on at the time until we hit the mine, and all of a sudden they turned and they closed down on top of us. So my initial concern, to go back to what we're here for tonight, is how do I fight the ship to the fullest of my ability? I've lost one diesel. It's totally destroyed. I'm in another one that's fractured, and the oil's pouring out of the bottom of it as fast as we can get it into it. I've got one other diesel available, and I've got number one diesel up forward that I have to get on the line. I've lost all my controllers. My engineering controllers and my EPSI panel are gone. And so I've got to get power to my gun and my missile system, and that is my driving concern. But to do that, I have to balance the load. And so a lot of things are going on. Finally, I get enough power, bring a missile up on the rail, and as the Iranian P-3 flies over the top, I inform him that if he flies over me one more time, I'll shoot him down. And he flies away. And then the Sabalon closes down to about 10 miles, and I inform him if he sticks around, we're going to shoot him too. And so he leaves. Kind of makes you a little concerned. The only guy that's going to help you is gone away. We're in the middle of a minefield, and the nearest U.S. ship is 148 miles away. They're coming, but they're not going to get there. And it's now sunset, and it's getting dark. So we're pretty much in this battle by ourselves in a minefield, and it is all on the crew and all of that training that I told you about that's going to make a difference. I'm going to show you some slides here in a second. Could you please go to the next slide? This is our situation 2 hours after the fact, and I want to come back to this if I can. So if you can go on, I'll show you the rest of the damage. This is, the ship is broken in two, and this is the superstructure. We're broken in half. Next slide, please. It's split all the way down, and the only thing that is not broken is the starboard side, which looks like a ratcheted beer can on the hull. Next slide. This is the main engine room, and the Hopham, could you put that back up? The Hopham, which is 26 feet below and is welded on the keel, is now stuck in the overhead in this space. After the explosion, the three individuals that were in that space and were trying to get out were trapped below the deck plates. And the sailors from Repair 5 are in the space putting out the fires, and they can't get the three sailors that are trapped under the deck plates out. So they climb over the rubble, put a battle lantern down under the water, and the three of them swim to the battle lantern, and they pulled them out of the water and saved their lives. So putting out the fire and saving the lives of their fellow sailors, saving what's left of that space. Next slide. This will give you an example of the flames staying above the ship for about 2 hours. And I had to make a decision at one point because we were sinking at the rate of about a foot every 15 minutes. And the problem was we were running out of freeboard. And I had put one of my most responsible petty officers back on the starboard quarter of the ship and told him to tell me what the relationship was with the water and the numbers on the starboard quarter of the ship. And at one point I was standing in the midship's passageway and my shoes were filling with water, but the flames were burning less than 5 feet above my head. And I called back to the starboard quarter of the ship and asked, what's the status of the numbers versus the water? And Petty Officer Sample said to me, I have no idea, Captain. And it was the only time that night I literally lost my temper and said, I put you back there for a reason. And he said, Captain, the reason I can't tell you where the water is with regard to the numbers is the numbers are gone. I can't see them anymore. And I said, how bad is it? And he said, if I get down on my knees, sir, I can put my hands in the water. We had about 2 feet of freeboard left. And at that moment, it suddenly dawns on me that all this water that we're pouring on the ship to put out the fires is pouring down through the ship into my shoes. We're sinking ourselves. So I immediately left the midship's passageway, went to the bridge, and walked on the bridge and gave the order at time, whatever the time was. Commanding officer orders the cessation of fighting all fires on the ship, to which my XO was rather disdained about. But we stopped fighting the fires. We threw a helo engine over the side. We started throwing torpedoes over the side. I gave the order to throw 76 millimeter ammunition over the side. Keep that in mind. You would think that when you tell your troops to throw the ammunition over the side, that they would take it out of the watertight containers. No, you gotta tell them that. So they were throwing it over the side in the watertight containers and it was floating. For all your people that are wonderful taxpayers, we marked the place on the map where we threw on the chart, but we threw them all in the water and we recovered everything. So, but we lightened ship and we stopped fighting the fires and essentially stopped the sinking and held ourselves steady. We established flooding boundaries, we dewatered the ship, we secured everything that we possibly could, we let the ship keep burning. And then the first helicopter arrived, the 46 came in with some water because we had no fresh water left and we had been fighting the fires for about 2.5 hours. And Trigates and Y-Gates, and when they came in, they brought a large 250-gallon fuel bladder on the aircraft and they wanted to know if we'd like to keep it for them. And our flight deck guy said, hey, do you see what's going on here? We're on fire and burning. And so they threw it in the water astern of the ship. And when I came back to the flight deck later to see how everything was going as we had evacuated our most seriously wounded individuals, I saw this magnesium smoke float in the water off the starboard quarter. And I asked the flight deck officer what that was, and he said, well, Captain, there's a magnesium smoke float in the water, and I thought, there's a large JP-5 fuel bladder in the water, and I thought you'd like to know where it was, so I threw the magnesium smoke float in the water to mark it. As he was saying that, out of the corner of my eye, I saw the 76 millimeter ammunition floating around the port quarter, to which I said, this is not my best day in the Navy. But it was actually my best day in the Navy, and I left the flight deck. I went to the bridge. We had control of the fires. The young man that was up in AMR-1, who was not qualified, had never been checked out in anything, started number one diesel and brought the power to the switchboard. Why? Because in all of that training I told you about, he had paid attention and listened and knew the EOS card, and he was able to start a diesel that was way above his pay grade, and he was able to bring the power to the switchboard and, in essence, save the ship. And so we had the power to generate foam, which we knew we could use to put the fire out. We had the power now to lower the APUs and start trying to get out of the minefield and get the heck out of there and get away from that mess. And so we balanced out what we had as power. We energized the APUs. We came to course 146 and we drove out of the minefield that had 14 mines. We drove 26 miles on the APUs by ourselves in the dark. And felt pretty good about it, to be honest with you. One thing I didn't tell you was after the explosion, the snakes and the sharks decided to have a convention with us. The noise kind of excited them. And there's nothing worse than being the CEO of your ship with all of these things going on and having your signalman saying, God, Captain, look at that guy. Look how big he is. So that was funny. Come on. that's a very rapid, quick calculation. Or a recap of what happened to us and how we got out of the minefield. The last piece of it is you saw in that one picture, and let's go to the next slide, please. That one picture with the gas turbine ejection ports that are moved on the upper part of the ship where you saw how the ship was cracked in two. The final decision on how we were able to get the fires out was simply that my chief engineer came to me and we decided that the fire was burning inside the gas turbine modules. And every time we put foam down in one place, it just moved around. So we had to get access to the whole thing. And my chief engineer, Gordon Van Hook, said we got to take one of those gas ejection ports off and get all the hoses down, and that's how we'll flood it and put it out. I really didn't want to do that because I was afraid of a chimney effect that would make the fire ignite even more. And by this time, my crew was exhausted. We had been in it by ourselves. They were really tired. And finally, Van Hook convinced me that was the route we had to go. We gave the order to the sailors to take the bolts off the gas ejection ports. They didn't have the tools, but only sailors could do this. They got all 80 bolts off in about 20 minutes with every other type of contraption. And then we put large crowbars underneath the hatches, and on the count of three, we pushed it over, and the flames shot up and singed all of our eyebrows and my hair. And my chief engineer, who was standing tactically behind me, said, maybe this wasn't a good idea. Maybe we should have waited until tomorrow. But it was the right idea. We turned the hoses on, beat the fires down, and all of a sudden the smoke went from black to gray to white. And for the first time in about 4 hours, we looked at each other and said, we think we've done this. We think we've got the fires out. We're driving out of the minefield. I think we've won this thing. And that in a brief capsule, is the story of Samuel B. Roberts and the mining on April 15th, 1988. A tremendous crew, very well trained, very courageous and very brave, never lost their sense of humor and never lost their sense of fighting their ship, and we're not going to give it up. And I want to leave you with one thought about that heritage, if you ever want to play that down and think it's not important. We had a plaque on the ship that had the name of everybody who was killed, or everybody that was on board Samuel B. Roberts at the Battle of Samar. And it was kind of a monument on the ship, just a big brass plaque. And during the night, as things went on, I noticed, didn't think much of it at the time, every sailor going by was touching it. And then I realized that every member of the crew was touching it. It was their moment to reach back to history and show that now they were walking in their footsteps and they were not going to give that ship up, and they didn't. And I think, the question about how did we save the ship, you know, when everybody says we should have lost it. Navy builds great ships. Bath Ironworks does a great job. But the incredible willpower and skill and tenacity of the American sailor, just a tremendous performance. And that's my story, and I'm sticking to it.
Paul, thank you very much. Commander, over to you, sir.
Do you want that thing?
Yeah, we'll give it a try. First slide.
How did I do on this one? Wait, okay.
You're going to have to ratchet through these items.
Yep, just keep punching through them. I would say, like Captain Rinn, when you get that opportunity to stand on the flight deck like I did with friends and family in front of you, and you say the three greatest words of a naval officer's career, I relieve you. And believe it or not, those three simple words, you instantly carried out a centuries-old, time-honored tradition, where as commanding officer, you assumed total accountability and responsibility, in our case, for $1 billion national assets and the lives of every single sailor working underneath you. And the key thing I did when I walked on board is, intuitively I knew that no matter how I wanted to lead the ship, it was my job as the captain to make sure that my crew understood what the standards were, because they needed to know how each and every single one of them were not only going to live up to those standards, but that they were going to contribute to the vision that was going to make that ship. Each of our ships out there has a tradition. This is the crest for USS Cole. It was named after Sergeant Darrell Cole, Medal of Honor awardee, Iwo Jima. Three grenades come from when he attacked, three pillboxes before he was killed on his third attack going up there. A lot of history. We were the first ship named after him. So when I took command, said those three words, and set those standards, there were a number of things that I tried to put into place. I wanted to make sure that the goals were set, and not just set to maintain where the ship was. We'd been the battle awardee for the last 2 years in our squadron, but I wanted to make sure that the ship could do something else as well. Next slide. And that was about 6 months before deployment, there were a couple things that I put into place to make sure the crew understood how they were going to achieve those things. I wanted to make sure they understood that each of them was going to contribute. We rearranged berthing compartments. I had men and women aboard the ship at the time, but I was undermanned in a number of rates. The Navy said, you have X number on board. Well, think outside the box. Nobody says I can't reconfigure berthing compartments. Went to the Bureau of Personnel and said, now I've created more slots. I have shortages. Get me everyone you can to fill in here. You've got women ashore that want to come to sea. Here's their golden opportunity. So when we would deploy, we would have about 30% more women aboard the ship than men. And I think that that would make a huge difference because it bumped those numbers up. When we deployed, when you set standards for people and you set them high, it's an amazing thing that they will reach to achieve them every single time. And on USS Cole, we set that standard. Navy ships, when they deploy, pull away from the pier. We always perform a ceremony called manning the rail. You're in your dress uniforms, parade rest, every horizontal level. As USS Cole pulled away from the pier in Norfolk, Virginia, we achieved something that had never been done before in the Navy and has never been repeated since. Every single one of my officers manned the rail. Not one officer manned a watch position. It was a 100% qualified enlisted crew. That's officer of the deck, junior officer of the deck, junior officer of the watch, helm safety officer, after steering helm safety, engineering, CIC, everywhere they went, the officers were out and the enlisted were running it. And as we sailed into the Atlantic, if you think for one second that that crew was happy, pleased, and proud, not a chance. That was time away from kids' soccer games, time away from home, time not getting honey-do list. What that would give them, though, was 2 months later when almost 20% of the crew was killed and injured in the attack, they had the confidence, not only from a technical standpoint in knowing the systems on their ship, but more importantly in my eyes, that leadership quality in each and every individual to now step into those vacant positions. And as I go through what happened during the attack, you'll understand why that was so critical. So we sailed across the Atlantic Ocean, went into the Mediterranean, operated for 4 weeks, suffered miserably through Barcelona, Spain, Villefranche, France, Valletta, Malta, Koper, Slovenia. It's tough duty. You joined the Navy to see the world. This was their opportunity to do it. Enjoy it. Have a great time. But our real mission was actually to go to the Arabian Gulf and to follow up what was going on from the tanker wars. We were going to make sure that the United Nations sanctions imposed on the country of Iraq could stay there. That was our real mission. Next slide. So we would sail across the Med, go through the Red Sea, come down. Because we had been held back a little bit in the Mediterranean, our race across the Eastern Mediterranean and down the Red Sea was done at 25 knots. When we rounded the corner of Strait of Bab el-Mandeb and we were outside the port of Aden, Yemen, we were below 50% fuel. As you know, Navy ships, they typically like to stay up around that 70 to 80%, keep themselves operationally flexible. Early the morning of the 12th of October, we would pull into the port of Aden, Yemen. As I came in, I made my first force protection decision, turned the ship around and wanted it pointed bow out so that if anything happened, it was a straight shot to get back out to sea. We moored starboard side to the pier. By around 9:30 in the morning, I have shut down the four main engines, the power of the two shafts of the three generators we had operating, left two online and prepared to refuel the ship, taking on fuel at 300 to 500 gallons a minute, 250,000 gallons or so. We'd be there for at least 6 to 8 hours pumping fuel. The sooner we get started, the sooner we finish. One of the things that we arranged for while we were in port, in addition to refueling, was pumping off sewage, topping off fresh water, when we also contracted for three garbage barges to come out to the ship and take trash off. Crew lined up, that was all in progress. I was sitting in my cabin, 11:18 in the morning. We've been refueling for about 45 minutes at this point when it was literally a thunderous explosion. When the explosion hit, we were violently thrust up and to the right. The force of the explosion reflected off the seabed. Water doesn't compress. It lifted the entire ship up about 10 feet. We bowed in the middle, bent underneath. Lights went out. Ceiling tiles popped out. Everything lifted up about 10 feet on my desk and slammed back down. And as the ship slid back down in the water, once it stopped moving where I could let go, it was complete pitch dark. Went to the door of my cabin, two battle lanterns, one at my door, one halfway down the passageway, shining light. A gray cloud comes down, washes over me, and you could smell the smoke. You could smell fuel. But there was also this acrid metallic tang. We didn't know what it was. Within seconds, I knew we'd been hit. If it had been an explosion from fueling on the pier on the ship, we would have been pushed left. We'd been thrust up into the right. So I instantly perceived that something had come alongside and detonated. I went back into my cabin, grabbed 9mm, took a deep breath, went out because I needed to get to the port side. Went down, looked over the side, next slide, for the first time saw the hole in the side, and you could clearly tell from the indentation of the metal, something external had detonated, shoving all the metal into the ship. At this point, I have seen one, maybe two sailors. My chief gunner's mate is responding with his security teams. I see four orange rafts alongside the ship, and I watch all these sailors flooding out onto the flight deck, trying to figure out what's happened. I didn't know the security situation, may make the best decision. I will tell you that when you're in a crisis, you will make the best decision you can based on as much information as you gathered at that instant in time, knowing that it might be the wrong decision, but you have to make a decision on what to do next. I shoved all the sailors back inside the ship because I was worried about security and didn't know if we were going to start taking sniper fire or anything like that. I went up to the bridge and contacted the Yemeni port authorities, asked them for three things: send out small boats, notify your local hospitals, and make sure that whoever came out to the ship stayed at least 100 meters away from us. Next slide. I would leave there to the bridge, knowing we had got a stable situation and the Yemenis were going to come out and help us. Went down to my cabin, grabbed a flashlight in the dark, and started all the way down. And the way the ship is configured internally is there's two passageways that run all the way down the port and starboard sides, bisected by three passageways that are each near a repair locker that we use for damage control on the ship. As I start walking toward the back end of the ship on the starboard side, I get my first piece of good news. In the back end of the ship, there are lights on. Right then and there, I don't know how or why, but we have a generator running, which means I can get power to pumps, which means I can save the ship. But when I get to the middle of the ship, one of my three repair lockers is jammed shut by the force of the explosion as no one is around. So I'm down one third on damage control. I rounded the corner, next slide. That's the mess line where the crew had just lined up to get lunch. Chicken fajitas, grab their tray, get their lunch, get to the end, take a left and walk into the mess decks. But as I get to this passageway and round the corner from where the repair locker is that's jammed shut, this is what I see next. It's a wall of metal. Can't walk down the passageway. Backed out, find myself standing in front of medical. Open the door, no one's around. I don't know where my medical team is. I don't know whether they're alive, dead, or wounded. So I have no idea if I've got a medical capability. The mess deck serves as the triage area, but I go to open the doors onto the mess decks. They've been blown in, and the mess decks is in the dark, so I don't have a triage area. I walk over to the port side of the ship. When I get there, that's the port passageway. If you look just past that watertight door to the right is the mess line coming from the other direction, so you're looking toward the bow. But as I get there, this is the picture I see. Just beyond that, decks folded up at a 60-degree angle, completely cutting off the left side of the ship, so it's not available for damage control. Back into the middle of the mess decks when I can actually see light, and I still don't have an accurate damage assessment. So I walk up to where my mess deck or my galley used to be. When I get there, next slide, that's what the galley is supposed to look like. That's what the galley did look like. Nothing is recognizable. The interior of the ship is utterly devastated. I can turn to my left, take a couple steps, and you can see that one piece of metal that peels up. What happened is when the explosion hit and projected into USS Cole, it went directly into main engine room number one. When it went into main engine room number one, it took the overhead of the engine room, which was the deck in the galley, and ripped it into four main pieces. One peeling up into the left, cutting off the left side of the ship that you saw earlier. One peeled and slammed forward into my chief's mess. One peeled back into the mess line, crushing and trapping sailors. The other acted like a giant scoop and took everybody that was working in the galley and along the mess line and began to crush and shove them toward the starboard side of the ship. You could look out the hole in the side, and you could smell fuel and lots of it. We estimated the Yemenis, actually, that 300 to 500 gallon per minute rate, when we first started, settled out at 2,000 gallons per minute. They ended up pumping for at least 5 to 7 minutes after the blast, and you could smell tons of fuel down in that hole that were now leaking up the side of the ship. But it's not what I smell that worries me. It's what I hear. Because down in that hole, we have not been able to electrically isolate main engine room number one, and now I'm hearing the worst possible sound. It's the popping and crackling of live electrical wires dipping in and out. And I'm thinking, not only have we had a devastating explosion, now we're going to have a major fire on my hands. I had to leave and get to the central control station, co-located with Damage Control Central, and find out what's going on. I left this area, walked back through the darkened mess decks, and out into the lighted portion of the ship for the first time. But as I round the corner, down on the deck is something a captain never hopes he sees. One of my sailors is on the deck. It is clear from the extent of his injuries that he's dead. Two sailors are standing there in disbelief that this is happening, just looking down at him. All I did was make an assessment, walk up, and said, hey, all it took was that slight bump. They locked eyes with mine, and they were back in it. Looked at the first one, said, where's your general quarter station? He says, repair two, sir, and headed toward the forward end of the ship. The other one, without my even asking, said, repair three, started to take off. I had to call him back, tell him to go get a couple blankets so we could get our shipmate covered and moved out of the way. Then I came face to face with the reality of earlier decisions. When the blast hit the ship, it knocked the announcing system offline, the battery backup failed, and because of design flaw, the alarm systems did not work. That's why there was complete silence on the ship after the attack. No one could tell the crew what had happened, where to go, or what to do. And what had they done? All that training, all that time invested in learning systems, it all paid off. Because they fell back on their own. I may have been the captain, it wasn't going to make a difference for a few minutes afterwards. Each of them fell back on their training and divided into one of three groups. They either went to the repair lockers to work on damage control, they went to work on triage to try and save their shipmates' lives, or they were part of the security teams to stop another attack. Next slide. We're sitting alongside the pier. Damage control-wise, we ended up having main engine room number one flooded completely, then progressive flooding behind that, where auxiliary machinery room number two flooded, then the supply office above that and the reefer deck above that, cracks in the bulkhead leading forward and aft. We were actually able to get the ship stable because one of the things we had done when we pulled in was set modified condition zebra, maximum watertight integrity, main deck and below. That did two things for us. One, it contained the flood waters as they began to go out despite the damage. But two, because we had compartmented the ship like that, the force of the blast dissipated through all those watertight spaces, which allowed them to keep up the structural integrity of the ship. Fortunately, we were hit at the widest part of the ship, 66 feet, about 60 feet at the waterline on a DDG 51 class ship. So what ends up happening? I go up, knowing we're stable, I turn the damage control effort over to the executive officer to maintain, knowing we weren't going to lose the ship right away, started doing triage effort. We were evacuating wounded. The brow that you see at the back end of the ship, that's not down. This isn't a port visit. There was no need to put it there. That decision's now working against me because I still have to get people off. Why? I'm in the golden hour. The clock's ticking. The Yemeni boats are coming out. How do I get wounded off? We would lean an extension ladder that was down on the pier up against the ship at about a 45-degree angle, and the way we'd get wounded off is tie them into a metal litter, strap them down tight, drag them to the edge, tie two lines to the feet and throw it to the workers, two lines to the head, and literally tip them over the side, onto the ladder, slide it back and forth till it got down on the pier. That's risk management on the fly. I had no choice, no flotation devices, no guarantee the lines were tied right, no way of knowing that those sailors, if they had hit the water, would have gone down and there would have been nothing I could do, but I've got to get them off the ship. So they go down on the pier, they go into the hospital. We would continue to get people off the ship like that until back at the brow when we finally got it down to the pier. In the middle of all this, while the brow is being wrestled around and we're starting to get the wounded ready to go, my navigator, who had been on the bridge when I first got up there, had come down at the 30-minute point, is now standing in front of me. Says, Captain, we're sending wounded ashore, but we don't know which hospital they're going to. We don't know what their treatment regimen. We don't really know what their wounds are. I recommend we send someone ashore to track them. I said, great idea, Nav. Who do you recommend? I said, sir, I'll volunteer to go. I said, fine, it's going to take a little over an hour. When that brow goes down, I want you to be the first one off. Go with one of the wounded and let me know what you need. Yes, sir. She walked off. walked down the brow about an hour later once the brow was down, goes into the hospital. A little while later, get word back to us. We would send 20 blood donors ashore with about 5 petty officers to help track the wounded. That evening, the French would fly a medevac aircraft in. They would take the most critically wounded, 11 of them, and fly them to Djibouti, and the next day, the Air Force would take everyone out. 22 out of Aden, 11 out of Djibouti. Unfortunately, even with French medical team working on him, I'd lose one sailor. How well did the crew do that day? We would evacuate 33 wounded off the ship in 99 minutes, and of those 33, 32 survived. That's why you practice the medical piece of damage control as well. It saves lives. So what ends up happening? My navigator could have left the ship, could have left with the Air Force, gone back stateside, and I never would have questioned her motives. She's looking after my crew. She didn't do that. This is why each and every person in here that's ever gone to this institution is told read and know message to Garcia. Who do you recommend? I'll go. Go. That was the extent of the conversation. My navigator goes off, tracks the wounded, goes into a foreign country, not knowing the force protection conditions, goes to another country, gets on a third airplane, could have left, didn't do that. 2 days later, she flew back into Aden, got on a boat, came across the harbor, walked across the refueling pier, back up the brow, and reported back aboard for duty. That's the level of dedication that I was blessed with on that ship. Absolutely phenomenal job. So when you read that message to Garcia and it's kind of disconnected from the real world, trust me, it's not, because that's the reality of how I lived with it on the ship. Meanwhile, we'd be working to keep the ship afloat. Modern 21st century wooden wedges and this waxy rope substance called oakum. You've all heard of that? Well, here you go. There it is. That's the shaft as it came into main engine room number 2. That shaft had shattered and was leaking at about a 20-gallon per minute leak rate right after the explosion. This is about an hour afterwards. We've pounded all those in. The leak rate's now down to a trickle. Next slide. I did not have power to circulate air or cool it down, so where did we sleep? Out under the stars for the next 5 or 6 days. This is the reality of what we had to live with. There were pieces of boat and bomber all over the topside of USS Cole. What had happened is 2 garbage barges had come out, picked up trash, they had left. What we didn't know is Al-Qaeda had been in the port for over a year, watching when Navy ships pulled in, what pier they went to, what boats came out. What I didn't know is the 2 boats were supposed to dump trash and one of them come back out to the ship. As they're halfway across the harbor, though, the third boat heads toward me, came down the side of the ship, came to the exact same spot in the middle of the ship where the previous garbage barge had been. We thought it was the third garbage barge, and the security teams let it down, came to the middle, detonated. The blast moved at about 25,000 feet per second. All the damage you saw to USS Cole was over in about less than 3 milliseconds. That's how quick those high-order explosives work. So we're sitting here surviving through all of this. We're alongside the pier. Saturday night, we're doing well. Dewatering auxiliary machine room number 2. My only operating generator number 3 quit. What would end up happening is we'd go through a cascading series of crises. If things can go from bad to worse, they always will. I have 3 chances to restart the generator with 3,000 PSI high pressure air. 1, 2, 3, generator doesn't start. Saturday morning, I end up having to cut a hole in the side of the ship. But when I go to cut the hole, the battery on the cutting torch is dead. I'm now in a foreign port with a hole in my side, hot, dark, quiet, and sinking next to the pier. Got so bad that they actually called and woke up the president at 4:30 in the morning and told him that we were sinking and they didn't think we could save the ship. Don't ever give up. Ever. When you're backed into a corner, there's always going to be a way out. Because we turned at that point and we decided, let's get a bucket brigade. We found every bucket, made every bucket, and for 15 minutes, we were bailing water out of main engine number 2 till we got a torch brought in from another ship, cut the hole in the side, started a P-100 pump, got it running in discharge, hanging on by our fingernails, and then God loves sailor ingenuity, because one of them came to me and said, hey, the self-contained breathing apparatus that the firefighters use, same as you see in fire departments throughout the U.S., if we took one of those, or 2 of them that we had on board that were portable, hooked them up on the flight deck, ran the hoses down to number 3 generator for the flask, where we pulled the line off the gauge board, or the gauge line off the board itself, jury-rigged fittings, and ran those pumps for 14 hours at 5 minutes after midnight, two shots of high pressure air, restarted the generator, and that's how we had power the rest of the time we were in port. So that's the self-contained breathing apparatus bottle I love to show. It's the sailor ingenuity that'll keep it. If you create the conditions to trust and invest in your people, it is amazing what they'll accomplish. Next slide. Sitting alongside the pier, this is the view from the safe house window that Al-Qaeda had. So that's how they were able to watch and observe us for all those months. Here we are, get towed down the coast. Time for us to go home. SS Blue Marlin, big heavy lift ship. We got towed those 23 miles. The picture on the front of the book is us getting towed right after we left Aden Harbor. We're positioned over the Blue Marlin when it lifted us up and out of the water. The reason we're cocked off at a 17 and a half degree angle is we have to keep the center of gravity low, but the sonar dome up forward, we want to make sure we preserve it. There were discussions of actually getting a torch and cutting it off, leaving it at the bottom of the bay in Aden. We decided not to do that. We could keep it like this. But then the CEO, Blue Marlin, said, want to go take a look? I dropped down in a yellow basket. And just to give you an idea of perspective, that's a guy in a white t-shirt on deck. Cracks went to within 18 inches of the keel. Our keel held, but the patrol measured 40 by 40 feet. It was like a giant punched his fist in, pulled it back out. But it was the sailors that kept that ship afloat. They're the ones in that defining moment, led by you out here when you become officers in a few years that are going to be in charge of them. Trust and invest in them. Take time to know them and lead them. Set high standards for them because it's amazing what they will accomplish.
Commander, 1 minute.
In closing, good timing. That's USS Cole today, repaired, fixed, port side, and I was extremely proud to know that this last spring she actually led the parade of ships into New York Harbor, where kind of sends a signal to midshipmen, to the world, that we do have the greatest Navy in the world, we have built the best ships in the world, and that we are still very, very capable of defending not only our nation, but freedom around the world. So, thank you.
Commander, Captain, thank you very much. Before we begin Q's and A's, I just have to observe for the midshipmen here. You will read over the next 4 years or 3 years or 2 years or 1 year, depending on what class you're in. You'll read a lot of history. You'll read a lot about damage control. What you have heard tonight is absolutely invaluable. These are two captains who lived it and survived it, and because of the training and the leadership that they provided to their ships survived. This is an incredible experience for you, and I think it is a wonderful one for you. I thank the both of you very, very much. So let me begin with the questions. There's no question that both of you were extraordinary leaders, without question. But let me ask you a question. Now that you've had time to think back over the experience, for Paul, many years, and Commander, for you, wow, 14 years now, right? So let me ask you, beginning with Captain Rinn, what would you have done differently, looking back on it, to have made it better?
I'd avoided the minefield.
That's the second question.
That's the second question. You know, I think that looking back on the philosophy of command that Commander Lippold and I have stressed here is empowering your people. And what I would have done differently, I don't think there is a lot that I would have done differently. I was a very aggressive commanding officer. I stressed the people on the ship. We drilled and we practiced and we thought about what might happen to us. The reality was that one of the things I hadn't talked about is when we struck the mine and we were very badly damaged, the bulkhead in AMR-2, which we had lost the main engine room in AMR-3, were gone.
Everybody know what AMR is? Some don't know.
Auxiliary machinery rooms. And you have a main engine room where your gas turbine engines are, and then after it you have your dehydrators and some diesels, and forward you have two diesels and fire pumps and everything else. On a frigate, if you lose AMR-2, you're doomed because you have two diesels, but you also have your fire pumps and you have most of the important stuff that you have on the ship. In our case, the bulkhead in AMR-2 was fractured, and there were three holes in it that were the size of large medicine balls. And all of the repair parties had gone to their different jobs. The engineers were fighting fires in the main engine room and up on top of the stack. The bosun mates were doing stuff on the main deck. And repair 5 or repair 3 was also working on the flight deck to do what they had to do. So we had a team of individuals that was one of the things that I talked about, that training everybody to do other jobs that they normally wouldn't be involved to do. And so they were down in AMR-2 saving the space. And when I arrived down there, we had a fellow by the name of Petty Officer Jackson, who was a radioman, and he was on our Fat Boy program. He was about 40 pounds overweight, and he had trouble passing his DC quals, but he told me he was all in, and he had volunteered for this special reaction team that we had, and they would have been on the mess decks. Well, he was the first guy down in the space, and when he got down there, he saw that the water was already up to his knees, and he realized from his training in damage control that the only way to stop this flooding was to pick up all the toolboxes in the space and stuff them in those holes and rip off all his clothes and stick them around the toolboxes. And he stopped 95% of the flooding in the space. And then he tried to put oakum in the fracture that was across the bulkhead. And of course, they tell you when you start hammering in oakum, if the flooding gets worse, ooh, there's water on the other side, so I better not do that. So by then, the chief cook, who had been complaining about, you know, spinach, had now arrived with all the other key guys to save the engineering space, the postal clerk, an ICman, a bosun mate, the cook, and a radioman, okay? And they're all down there, and he has a great decision. We need mattresses. Go to the chief's quarters and get all the chief's mattresses. Brilliant. And so they came down. Those 5 guys are not engineers. But the cross-training and the innovativeness of getting people to do other jobs paid huge dividends. I want to go back. I told you about casualty power. One of my exo thought I was nuts, and you may think this when people say to you, why are you doing that? It's way above and beyond. Because warfare is way above and beyond. It will stress you, as you've heard from Commander Lippold and me, more than you've ever been stressed in your entire life. Yeah, we rig casualty power every month. Navy's requirement is 1 hour. That night on Samuel B. Roberts, postal clerk, radioman, 2 bosun mates, rigged casualty power with 2 electricians in 28 minutes, brought power to the after end of the ship. Pays dividends. What would I have done differently? Nothing. I probably would have worked them harder. But the one thing that's important is you never work your people harder than you work yourself, and you never, ever, ever, let them think that you don't care about them. You're not there to be their friend, but if you bring them all home alive and in one piece, you're the best friend they ever had, and it doesn't matter that they know. Lead them and lead them well, and bring them to a level of performance that they never thought they could achieve. And make sure that you trust them and they trust you. And you can do that by working hard at it. Okay.
Commander.
In that defining moment, there's nothing that I can change. In looking back, if I were to say if there's one thing I would do is, in a defining moment, leadership came up, but I would trust and invest in my people even more than I did in that that moment, because it truly is the people that work for you that can make things happen. I was at the opposite end of the scale on the casualty power. The ship was stable damage control-wise. I'm standing in the middle of all the triage effort when my chief electrician's mate came running up to me and said, Captain, we need to rig casualty power. Request mission to do it. I said, fine. Follow EOS, the engineering operating and sequencing system, all the steps that tell you how to do it. Follow EOS, follow the safety procedures, go do it. And he looks at me point blank and says, Captain, we've never rigged casualty power. And in that moment, with everything going on, I'm thinking to myself, okay, I know we never did that drill during my time with all the damage control drills that we've done to date. But now is not the time to be busting the captain's chops about it. So I looked at him and I said, okay, follow EOS, follow the safety procedures, hook it up. He said, but sir, I don't think you understand. We've never done it. USS Cole had been in commission since June of 1996, and we got hit in October of 2000, and they had never run a casualty power exercise or drill on the ship. This was a guy who had commissioned the ship. So when you think you've done every drill on board, you probably haven't. And so what did I tell him to do? Follow EOS, follow the safety procedures, go make it happen. They took the cables down. This is where it pays to have done a lot of the other checks as well. Everything was where it needed to be. They hooked it all up. Of course, the one guy that stood at the switchboard was a little bit nervous when he went to go activate it with power, but guess what happened? It performed as designed. That's why we build the ships the way we do. And we had power forward into the ship. We needed to get lighting up there because it was complete darkness, and eventually the batteries and all the battle lanterns are going to run out. We've got to figure out and see what's going on. Make sure we can look and see the damage in order to control the damage that might be spreading in the forward end of the ship. So for me, I look at it and I just say, the people that come to work for you are truly going to look for you. They're, number one, going to want to know, what expectation do they have for me? You're going to set those goals and set those standards. They're going to want you to tell them, this is your job. This is the standard I want you to do to. This is the training I'm going to give you, the time you have to get that job done. Here are the tools you have available to you. And have a dialogue with them. Have a conversation with them. Okay? Just because you're going to be setting those high standards and be resolute in holding them to it doesn't mean that you don't care about them. Okay? One of the things I tried to do, one thing I always consider, there's one day a year that each of us has special that nobody's ever going to take away from us. That's our birthday. I always wrote a birthday letter to every single one of my sailors on board personally because I felt that was just my way of saying thank you for what you do on your special day. And oh, by the way, you're going to have a 72-hour liberty from that as well. So that pays dividends to them too. But it's taking care of them, making you realize it. I would be willing to bet if this event hadn't happened, most of my crew would have looked at me and said, yeah, he was a pretty good CO. Sure drove us hard. Wow, I don't know if it was worth it. But all you need is one incident like this, and I can tell you, it's you're bringing the people home. Unfortunately, 17 of my sailors never made it home. 37 were wounded. We paid a terrible price 11 months before 9/11. But if you talk to my crew today, they're sure glad that we trained as hard as we did and did what we did.
I'm going to open it up to the audience in just a minute, but I've got to ask one more question. And this is a question that goes beyond the lifelines of your ship. It's arguable that intelligence failed both of you, not your intelligence, but the intelligence to tell you where the minefield was, the intelligence to warn you about the terrorist threat in Aden. Is it your sense, and I know both of you have remained close to the Navy, since you have retired, is it your sense that intelligence, ISR, has improved in the 14 years since you were in command and had that event, and since 1988, Paul, when you had your event? Has naval intelligence improved, which reduces the probability of a god-awful event like yours and like yours happening again?
Yes and no. I think initially after USS Cole, there was an immediate focus on getting as much intelligence and information out to the commanding officers so that they could make a very informed decision as to the force protection posture for their ship when they pulled it into a port and how they were going to do that. One of the things that I always tell people is, look, you're given this long list of force protection measures to do. Tell me what the procedures are you're going to follow. Tell me the equipment that you're going to use. Tell me the training that you're going to give your crew to do that. Tell me whether the rules of engagement where you're operating are going to allow you to even do that measure. And then the bottom line comes down to, what is the intelligence that's driving you to do that measure? And you have to ask as the commanding officer, and for you as the junior officers out there that may have a collateral duty intel officer or force protection position on the ship, you need to be asking the question, what intelligence is driving us to do that measure? And if you don't have that answer, ask up the chain. Immediately after Cole, you could get all kinds of good answers on that, and they would give you the intelligence they'd need. But I think since then, as time goes by, familiarity at not getting attacked breeds contempt, and once again, the intelligence community is once focusing their intel up the chain of command versus down the chain of command?
Well, one thing when it comes down, everybody talks about intelligence and thinks that it's an art. It's not. 3 years experience in Southeast Asia. Yeah, we had a lot of reports. Sitting off of Beirut when I was the chief staff officer at Dejron. Lots of reports. Everybody needs to remember, the adversary has a say in it all. He's not asleep. You know, if you watch too many movies, you think the way it all works is, oh, we get this report and we go and do it. Well, you're watching too many movies. Our adversaries are smart. Our adversaries are capable. And guess what? They know our capabilities. And so they do things to defeat them. You know, why has ISIS been so successful in these attacks? Nobody's telling you. 25 trucks with suicide bombers lead the attack in northern Iraq. Nobody figured that one out. You don't even hear much about that. Our adversaries are good at what they do. So you must ask yourself this question all the time in a combat situation. What is it that I am most concerned about? What is it that I fear the most? And how can I train my people to counteract it or defeat that? So don't just try to rely on a piece of paper that you get that tells you this is the threat. Think for yourself, use your own common sense, and decide about that. In 1988, on Roberts, we almost shot down an aircraft coming off Abu Musa Island because we were sitting in the same place that Vincennes was years later and shot down an Airbus. We were out there and we had been told that Iranians were flying light aircraft that were suicide aircraft and that there was a chance they would fly into us. And all of a sudden, in the middle of the night at 2 o'clock in the morning in the rain, with all of this intelligence given to us, a plane came off, looked like it came off Abu Musa Island. The visibility was very low. Frigates are not AAW platforms. They have almost a point blank type of defense. And the plane flew right down at us. And I came into CIC, if you can imagine, you know, lying in Iraq, all of a sudden you're in CIC, it's 2 o'clock in the morning, here comes the plane, and my missile officer says, Captain, we gotta shoot this guy. And called up Mideast Force, told them the situation, and they gave us a green to shoot. Because the guy was closing us and met all the parameters to shoot him. And there was just something not right about it because we were locked on him, and he was closing us, and he wasn't the right speed. And I just said, not gonna do it. And within seconds after deciding to not shoot, over the circuit it came, Samuel B. Roberts, this is Middle East Force, abort, it's a friendly. The CIA was flying an aircraft over Abu Musa Island, and they had notified everybody on a different circuit. And it would have been, you know, just a terrible thing, blue on blue. So the whole issue about intelligence is you have to count on your own intelligence and think about what the threat will be and don't govern all your actions by what you read in a message that says the probability of attack might be. You have to be prepared. You have to be prepared for the worst case.
I'm going to add one little piece into that I think also feeds into it. As you spend more time in the Navy and you move up for the ranks, you gain something called experience. And by the time you reach a level as a commanding officer, those intel reports that all come in that feed into that, you need to read as many, if not all of them, every day, because you are going to be the best analyst at determining what the threats are to your ship. And if you don't pull that experience in to do that and do as much reading as possible to be able to synthesize those in a defining moment, you would end up with that blue on blue.
Claude, how many minutes do we have?
So why don't we go, if you're all okay with it, we'll go another 10 minutes and start taking your questions. So if you'd like to line up on either aisle, please first.
There we go.
We thought we were off the hook here.
Question is, sir, can you please talk to us about the political reaction after the attack? Specifically, I'm interested in the Senate Armed Services Committee. And second, do you think General Franks, in his capacity as commander of CENTCOM, provided you with all the necessary resources to avoid the attack from happening, sir? Thank you.
First one is actually somewhat irrelevant. For those of you who don't know, it dealt with promotion. I don't even really delve into it. The way I look at it when it comes to being commanding officer of a ship, if you want to look at who the accountable officer was that day, there was one. That was me. Period. Dot. End of statement. That's what you do when you take command. You say three great words, then you're the responsible guy for good, bad, better, or worse. So that ends that discussion. With respect to General Franks, you have to look through the entire chain of command. When we pulled into the port of Aden, Yemen, there were clearly shortfalls, and I think a lot of it dealt with how the entire intelligence community was operating at the time. We didn't even have any human intelligence assets in Aden at the time that can contribute toward building the picture. And Navy Criminal Investigative Service always built what was called a port vulnerability assessment so that they could tell commanding officers, here's what you expect when you pull into that port. The majority of that report was actually pulled from Yemeni sources that were interviewed by NCIS agents that would go in. So we really didn't pull from the entire intelligence community all the pieces to give me. So were there shortfalls? Did they have more intelligence at the central command level? Yes. Than they had at the 5th Fleet level? Yes. That they had at the battle group commander? Yes. That they had at my level? The highest threat message that I had on board that morning was secret, no foreign. Let's be realistic. That's one day ahead of the Washington Post at best. So the reality is we walked in there blind and not knowing that not only had Al-Qaeda been there a year, they had attempted an attack 9 months before the attack on Kohl that was not detected by the intelligence community. When USS the Sullivans pulled in, they attempted to launch a boat. It swamped at the pier. They recovered the boat, the explosives, the trailer, the car, moved to a new safe house, rebuilt the boat with the explosives built into it that resulted in, unfortunately, a successful attack against Kohl.
Sir, thank you, sir.
Good evening, gentlemen. Midshipman Fourth Class Dawson. First off, I want to say thank you very much for
a little closer to the microphone, please.
you can sorry, pull it up and raise it. Pull it out of its.
Thank you.
Not everyone's 5'6".
Thank you very much for sharing your experiences with us, gentlemen. My question regards protocol. Both of your experiences, you both mentioned that if there was a list of actions you could take to save the ship, you would take that. I was wondering if there's any protocol that you didn't specifically follow because you knew it wouldn't be the best action.
Well, yeah, there is a protocol. You know, you fight the fires until you put the fires out, stop the flooding, progressive flooding, et cetera. In the Navy, and this came up at the Board of Inquiry that I had to go to after the fact, you always put the fires out first. I knew when I went to the bridge of my ship that night and gave the order to cease fighting all fires on board the ship, that if the ship went down or that we suffered a severe casualty or whatever, that I would be held accountable for that. But you have to have flexibility. You have to understand, yes, these are the protocols that you have to follow with your priorities. But, you know, when my XO asked me to step out on the bridge wing when I gave that order and said, you know, what are you thinking? And that was not how he said it exactly, I said, John, we're sinking at the rate of a foot every 15 minutes, and in about 20 minutes, we won't have to worry about fires anymore because the Persian Gulf is going to put them out. So you had to step away from the protocol and say, I have to do what I have to do. And the entire time saying to myself, I wonder what I don't know. Am I just going to blow up here? Are we just going to explode? Because the flames were burning up above the ship. But we just couldn't keep going the way we were going. We were just pouring all this water on the ship. We had to stop. So you have to do one thing at a time, and you have to make those decisions. And so you have to deviate from protocols when you know. The other thing is you have to know your ship. And you have to know all sorts of things about it. Your buoyancy levels, you have to know your stability, you have to know your main drainage system. You have to really have a sense of what you got. And at the time, my sense was we had bottled a fire up. It was burning like hell, but it wasn't spreading. But I knew we were sinking like a rock, and we had to stop that. So
thank you, sir.
And for protocols with us, ours were more because of the circumstances, protocols would come ahead of time. And that was, I would put it down to, you know, this is a unique event in a terrorist attack. and that was the force protection conditions that were put into place. When we were headed there, we had a huge list of unknowns. We didn't know what pier we were going to go to, what side we were going to moor to, how many boats were going to come out, how many fueling hoses we had. Pre-9/11, what did you do? You pulled into port, you moored, and you figured all those things out, and you went about it. Unfortunately, when we pulled in that morning, I took a look at the circumstances and said, well, hey, I've got 63 security measures that I had told the fleet commander that I'm going to follow, to which he had stamped and said, yes, they all look good, follow every single one of them, even though he knew we were going to be moored to a pier out in the middle of the harbor where immediately half those measures wouldn't even apply to the physical circumstances we'd be in. What I was faulted for in the investigation, and rightfully so, wasn't that I didn't follow all those measures. It was that I didn't inform the chain of command that I was not following them, just so they would have some idea. Now, even if it were an after-action message, they wanted to know what was going on, and I didn't do that. When you look at the flexibility on the ship and what was going on, we had to innovate in how we get the wounded off. We had to innovate on communications. Initially, I had no communication to repair to in the forward part of the ship. So what do? You adapt to whatever comes on. We were starting to run what's called salt and pepper lines to get sound-powered phone communications, and that's really all we had, old-fashioned sound-powered phone communications. If there's one thing I tell you, don't trust technology. Technology takes power. If you don't have power, it doesn't work, okay? The damage control plates they have on ships, they're trying to take them off, don't let them go. Hold on to them with a bloody death grip, okay? Because when you don't have power, those nice plasma displays are going to be dark.
I totally agree with that, by the way. Everything you said, from sound pod phones to plasma displays and all of that stuff, that is a huge mistake that the Navy is making, and they will learn, they will come to regret it. So I totally agree with that.
Yes, ma'am.
Good evening, Midshipman Fourth Class Thatcher. First of all, thank you both for your service and for sharing your experiences and insights with us. My question is, in both your situations with the chaotic environment and things going in all different directions, as a leader, what do you do when you don't quite know what to do?
Well, let me step back on your question. You damn well better know what you're supposed to do. And in both of our cases, but I'll only speak for mine, you train your people. I trained everybody on Samuel B. Roberts to respond as if I took the first bullet and went down. And I told all of the members of my ship's company, I will never hold you at fault for a sin of commission, but I will definitely hold you at fault for a sin of omission. So they were all trained to act on issues that could happen. And remember when I made that statement about you think about what might happen to you and you train to it. Well, when Radium and Jackson shows up in AMR-2, he sees a hole in the bulkhead. We had trained to that. He didn't have to have anybody tell him what to do. He went and did it. And the rest of those guys who showed up in that space knew exactly what to do because they had trained. All throughout the ship, and I think we've both talked about this, you train your people to respond, and it's not as chaotic as you might think. It's a pretty catastrophic situation, but you'll be amazed if you train people, they automatically get up and move in the direction they know they're supposed to move. They go to their stations, they do their job, and they execute what they've been trained to do surprisingly well. And the object of the game in a combat situation is to eliminate chaos. If you look at pictures of things going wrong in a combat situation, or you see it in the movies with people shouting, they're not trained enough. It should be quiet. You want it to be as quiet as you possibly can to execute what you're supposed to do, okay?
I would absolutely agree. I will tell you that when the explosion hit and everyone was going to damage control stations, starting into the initial triage effort, when I would show up, no matter where I was, people would bring me decisions. Two things I wanted to do is, one is let them talk first, give me the information they needed, find out what the decision was they wanted, ask questions to garner as much information, and then make a decision. The one thing I had to tell myself continuously through this whole thing is no matter what anybody brings you, you as the captain must stay perfectly calm.
Absolutely.
Because if you begin to get up on edge, up on the governor, or get excited, that spreads by orders of magnitude down the chain of command, and that engenders panic. And that is the last thing you want. You want people to know that as bad as it may be, hey, if the old man's staying calm, guess what? Things must be under control. Let's keep marching forward. And that's what I would try and do, is make sure that you stay calm, get as much information. Don't be afraid. You've got to make decisions. You have no choice. Shoved everyone inside the skin of the ship. Guess what? 30 minutes later, we're shoving everyone out because I don't have a triage area, and I've got to have room out on the flight deck to be able to treat the wounded so that I can get them off the ship. I don't have a brow down. What do? You innovate. Hey, there's a wooden extension ladder. Lean it up against the side of the ship, and that's how we start getting the wounded off. How do we do it? Down in the engine room, they saw a leak. Pound around those wooden wedges in the oakum around the shaft seal to get it to stop. Cracks in the bulkhead. Hey, what works first? Start getting that putty and start putting it in there and see if that holds. And if that doesn't, see what else we can use to brace and bolt up against it to push. You just think on your feet. You practice drills and you do it with a certain routine and certain methodology, but you always give the crew something new in the drills they do because you want them to be able to react to different situations and think. You're never going to have something like occurs in a drill. It's always going to be different.
I just want to add one thing to this, and it's important. I'm sorry to extend this. A sense of humor doesn't hurt, okay? Crisis situation, and I'm going to relate this. My wife's in the audience. So I'm down in AMR2. The water's up to our knees, and it's not looking too good. So I called together those five guys I told you about, and I said, you've got to save that bulkhead, and we're in your hands. And if you don't save it, we're going down, and you're going to die right here. And I'm not telling you that to scare you. I'm telling you that so you can tell me whether you can handle it or not. And these 18-year-old kids looked at me and said, we got this, Captain. You got other things to worry about, okay? As I turned to leave the space, I honestly thought to myself, I don't think I'll ever see these guys alive again. And then, in a moment, you're all so young, somebody took a boom box and put it on top of a refrigeration unit and stuck in a journey tape. And captains have things said about them a lot, and my XO said, you know what they're saying about you now, don't you, Captain? This was weeks before, and I said, what's that? He said, Captain Rinn fears no man, but what he fears is that he'll come home some night and find one of us in his driveway in a Trans Am with one of his daughters listening to a journey tape. So I stopped at the foot of the ladder in this crisis situation with my ship sinking, surrounded by sharks, on fire, all of this, and came back and said, hey! Even now, your taste in music sucks. And they all laughed. Years later, they said, you know, when you did that, Captain, we knew we were going to make it. The point is, a sense of humor and keeping your control and keeping your head is huge with your sailors. Because if you're shook up, as Kurt just said, it's over. So keep that in mind, okay?
Thank you, gentlemen. Thank you.